Morning folks, Thursday morning, hope you're well. I'm humming and hawing, I can't decide if I should go with continuing my cigar from last night or having a pipe. I don't usually start with a cigar. It happens, but it's not very common. Unlike me. Cheers. So, different cup this morning. This is the BRTV cup, which is worn out. And the reason that I haven't got my usual cup is because I had a very late night cup of coffee last night. Decaf, whereas this is regular. or leaded, or unleaded, as you might call it. I've left it somewhere, the cup, and I can't remember where. It's either in the bathroom or it's downstairs already in the kitchen. And I haven't cleaned it out, and anyway, I couldn't be bothered, so cheers. Oh, that's hot. It's brass monkeys out there. Just been out, and it is freezing. The car display showed 2 degrees, but it felt colder than that. Just cleaning up a bunch of my pipes. And I've done a bunch of bulk coatings as well. It's kind of based on feedback that I got from a pipe show, Las Vegas pipe show, that my pipes had been at. So I'm basically, last night was all about putting coatings in pipes. It could be some pipes I'll still leave uncoated, like natural pipes, you know, unstained pipes possibly. Like this one, for instance. I've left this one on. I don't know if you can see it, but it's on. Does not have a bowl coating. The lighting is not great, but there you go. I did make a pipe yesterday, which is still in mid being made. It's essentially finished, but I just need to put the band on. It's a wonderful little, like a bull moose type. It's got stunning grain. It's got beautiful grain. Lovely bird's eye on the base. The lighting here is not going to help it out, but it's got a translucent stem which still needs to be sort of finished sanding and buffing, and there's a band to go on there which is going on it right at the end. A little bit of a plateau there on the rim. It's a gorgeous, gorgeous pipe. It's lightweight. No weight actually. It's really like a pot because it's got pot dimensions. 42 grams. Once that bend goes in, it's going to be very, very lightweight, very easy to clench. And this has got a fairly chunky shank and stem. Had I done a more slender one, it would have been, you know, in the 30 grams ish, 35, 38 grams, that kind of region. Still, very lightweight. And so I want to get that finished off as well this morning, if possible. Yeah, so yesterday was more about getting that pipe made and getting these coated. So they've had their coating on overnight, they're all fully dried out, which is good. You know what, I'm gonna start off with Amphora Virginia. I took this out yesterday when I was talking about when I was looking at some of my tobaccos. And I'm going to have it in the Ascorti. This Ascorti has a very neutral, tends to smooth out blends, and this particular tobacco is already smooth, so I figure just make it a completely smooth experience. I've been trying to look after my hands. They're so badly cracked at the moment. In the winter they always get worse. But they're in pretty poor shape right now. Actually, I'm not going to have a huge amount. It's always been quite a dark tobacco. There are some sort of slightly lighter, like kind of mahogany kind of colour, but it's generally quite a light, quite a dark tobacco. And you can also see what I've always liked about this tobacco is you can see that at some point it's been in cake format or flake format and then rubbed out. But it's a chunky flake. It's a chunky rubbing out, if that makes any sense. Almost like a broken flake. It's not as big as broken flake, but it's kind of a stage down from that. And you know, nearly all the strands are multi-layered, so you can see that they've been cut from something which has been pressed. It's not loose leaf, you know, it's not ribbon cut. And I've always liked that about this blend. This is my preferred kind of presentation. So in fact, if I have a flake tobacco, I'll rub it out to this kind of presentation. So you've got sort of, I don't know if you can see them, you might be able to see, it's too small. But basically they are sort of chunks with layers, like ogres. When you're pouring tobacco into a pipe, if you cup it like this and your hands are slightly above the rim, then anything that goes, that spills over the side, you just do that and it all goes in. You don't lose any tobacco. It's just something worth noting. Actually, this morning I found another box of these in the car. I left them in there for emergencies. It's good to know that I've got them. I don't know why I don't smoke this blend more. It's such a good blend. I don't know if you saw that, the head flew off right into my scarf or jumper or whatever. That's one of my complaints that I've been having about this, about these matches of late. They're just not reliable. And that has happened quite a few times to me with the head jumping off. when you first light this tobacco, it's really got quite a nutty kind of, it's a nutty and fruity sort of flavor, like a toasted nutty flavor along with fruit. That was a good choice. Good tobacco. But it does raise the question of matching tobaccos with pipes. And that just takes time. I've never done it in any kind of conscious way. I know I've spoken about this before. I actually had a look yesterday on my channel, and there's over 2,500 videos. So in over 2,500 videos, I'm going to repeat myself. And I know that I keep saying, I've said this before, but I'm just trying to let you know that I'm not going totally mad when I keep repeating myself. It's just because I'm aware that I'm repeating myself, but it's just something which I want to talk about. And everybody hasn't seen all of my videos, so it's worth repeating stuff sometimes. But I have forgotten the point I was making. Anyway, this tobacco, I was talking about matching tobaccos with pipes. It takes time to regurgitate the information and get to the point that I wanted to. And then it kind of clicks. Oh yeah, that's what I was going to say. So I know that there are people out there who record every single smoke on paper. They write notes of every smoke, what they experienced, which pipe they smoked it with, how long they smoked it with, what the temperature was in the room at the time, etc., etc. I'm the complete opposite of that. I just smoke my pipes, and that's it. I don't keep any record other than mental. As good as that might be. And of course, the occasional video, which is as good a record as any. Obviously, there's the danger that YouTube pulls the plug. The sensible thing would be to download all the videos, but that would be a mammoth task. I don't keep the videos. It uses up too much data. It boggles my mind how much data YouTube must have to store. I mean, millions and millions of terabytes. It's just mind-boggling. So, I don't keep a record of my smokes. But over time, you just seem to remember, almost by instinct, which tobacco goes with which pipes. And when you're deciding on a, depending on which way you're starting, which direction you're coming from, whether you fancy smoking a particular pipe on that given day, or you fancy smoking that particular tobacco, which that kind of informs which way around you make your selection. So if I fancy an Amphora Virginia, it led me to choose this pipe. If I would have fancied smoking this pipe, then I would have gone to Vanilla Roll Cake. You know, it's just a matter of which way around you're going. Oh, I should have said, this is the Escorti Christmas Limited Edition. Special Edition, sorry. Christmas 1997. And it's pipe 97 of 500. so quite limited. I have seen another one of these in the hands of Bernard Alotti. President of the Pipe Club of London. And although I'm a protagonist of said club, I don't get to join it anymore, which is sad. Other than for the virtual Zooms occasionally. And unfortunately the last couple I've not been able to make. I imagine there'll be one coming up soon. Where are we? The 21st. Funny, this is really smooth tobacco, but with a retrohale, it's got a beautiful zing. I wonder if you can get this in pound bags. I do have a few pouches of the stuff. But with pouches, you never know how long they're going to last. I've got the pouches in a jar. They're in that cupboard there somewhere. I've got three pouches in a jar. But I should really put them in a mason jar. At the moment, they're in one of these spring-loaded jars, which I'm not a big fan of. See it right now, but I suppose I should just either put the pouches straight into a jar, into a mason jar, or just open up the pouches and just jar it. This is from 2021, so those few years would have certainly improved it, no end. I'm heading into town a little bit later on today, so I'll probably pop into St. James's. Although, I don't think I'm going to be buying anything significant. A bit brassic at the moment. I just realised I haven't put a bowl coating on this one. I think there's a strong chance I might keep this one. This little notch here, it fits perfectly to put your finger in there. And it's just, it's like it's not there. It's like, fits like a glove. So we shall see. I kind of set it aside so I didn't put the bowl coating in it, but I just gotta keep resisting the temptation the whole time. It's right up my alley. It's got my favorite stem material. It's lightweight and it's a cool design. Ah, dear me, where is my lighter? Oh well, I guess we'll use the zipper. Right on my nose. Talking of Amphora Virginia, I first got to know the Amphora brand name. I think it's made by McBaron, if I remember correctly, under SDG. I think this bowl is almost done. It's got a tapered bowl with a bit of cake in there, so it hasn't got a huge capacity, and I didn't put a huge amount of tobacco in there, to be honest. I first got to know the brand with Amphora Full Aroma. Amphora Full Aroma is a blend which is, to me, it's got a bit of a kitchen sink kind of approach. It's got a lot of things going on in that blend. And when I first discovered it, I really, really enjoyed it, and I smoked it quite a lot. I have that kind of pattern with my smoking, that when I find a new tobacco that I like, I smoke it for quite a bit, and then I'll find something else, smoke that for kind of... The only one that's really stayed long-term has been Orly Golden Sliced and Northwoods when I'm in the mood for Latakia. I think this bowl is done. Amphora Full Aroma I discovered through Mordechai Azrati. And those of you who have been followers of my channel for a long time will have heard that name several times. A few years ago, more than a few years ago, I can't remember exactly when it was. Actually, I'll quickly search my channel. Alright, so the first video I did about this particular tobacco, this sort of bunch of tobaccos that I got from the Azrati cell, is 6 years ago, so that's roughly when it was. So essentially, there was a guy called Mordechai Azrati. He was an Israeli who, he was a property developer. Who married an English woman here in the UK and set up home in a country house. I can't remember exactly where it was, but he found pipe smoking and became obsessed. And he was an avid collector, had a massive collection of pipes, had a massive collection of tobacco. I mean, huge. We're talking about hundreds and hundreds of pounds of tobacco, of different tobaccos of all types. Tobacchiana, he had jars of tobacco, porcelain jars, like a whole room full of jars, like these porcelain Dunhill style tobacco jars. He had hundreds of tobacco pipe racks, pipe cabinets, etc., etc. Anything to do with pipe smoking he had, and it was his kind of plaything, it was his hobby. He was a wealthy man and he spent a fortune on it. And if you look up the Tilshead Pipe Company, or Upshall Pipe Company, he owned it for a while. When it was going bust, he decided that he was going to buy the company to prevent it going bust, or prevent it being taken over by one of the big conglomerates. And he basically paid the employees to carry on, and he kept it going for a few years. Such was his, you know, commitment to the hobby. A really fascinating guy. Anyway, so he married this English woman, and at some point he suffered a heart attack and passed away. In his, I think he was in his 50s maybe, not a very old person. maybe 60s, I'm not exactly sure, I don't remember. But his widow decided to sell off the stuff, and a lot of the stuff went to America, but she also decided to hold a sale at their home, at their country home. And it was held, it was publicized through the Pipe Tribe of London and so on. And the sale went ahead. It was on a Saturday, so I couldn't go. And I don't think it went very well. I mean, they sold some stuff, but they didn't sell a huge amount of stuff. Anyway, I got in touch with her, and she agreed that I could come along and have a look at the stuff and possibly buy some things. Which was very nice of her to do that, to give me a private audience, so to speak. So I arranged it, I went down there, and I bought a huge amount of tobacco. She was selling off the tobacco at a very fair price, more than fair. Obviously, she had really very little knowledge about the tobaccos, and she just put a flat price per tin, regardless of what it was. And to be honest, I was also quite early on in my in the hobby generally. And for me, it was a chance just to get some, especially to get some vintage tobaccos. And at that stage, you know, this wasn't about reselling it. You know, I wasn't doing consignments or any of that kind of stuff. This was just about me. I was in the early throes of my passion for the hobby myself. And I was just, you know, happy to get a chance to get some of these tobaccos. And it was a whole complete diverse range of tobaccos. There, you know, there were the bog standard Dunhills. In those days, there was no worry about Dunhill going away. And there were Dunhill tobaccos and McBaron tobaccos, and there were also McClellan tobaccos, and again, McClellan weren't going away either at that stage. So, although I don't think I found a single Esoterica tobacco there, funnily enough, but there were also some bulk tobaccos. There were some Dunhill, big Dunhill bags of tobacco, which I don't know what they were, and it's very possible that he had had those made at Dunhill, and at the time, I just didn't want to take the risk. Maybe it was a mistake, but I didn't buy them. You know, I could have had a big bag, like pound bags of tobacco for very, very cheap. But I didn't take the risk at the time. Again, I didn't have in mind resale or anything like that. So it was just about what I was going to smoke. Anyway, I did, if you have a look back and you search Ezrati, Ezrati, in my channel, you'll see the tobaccos that I bought. I bought a lot. And I also bought a bunch of pipes as well. And again, I knew nothing at that time about Upshaw, and she had boxes, you know, these big plastic storage containers, you know, like what I have my cellar stored in, that kind of size, full of brand new old stock Tills Head and Upshaw pipes. She had some, like, a whole box full of Magnums, which again was something which I didn't really know about at the time. And they just looked ridiculous to me. They looked so big that who's going to smoke them? And so I didn't buy any of those. And I was on completely limited income at the time. And so I really had to be very, very choosy about what I actually selected to buy. So I ended up buying... I didn't buy any Upshaws and I didn't buy any Tills Head. I bought a handful of Astley pipes. Astleys were pipes made by a variety of different English pipe makers at the time. So at the time you had Bill Taylor Ashton. There was some Dunhill, possibly some by, I'm trying to remember who the other makers were. Possibly by Chariton, I'm not sure. But anyway, I bought a few Astleys, and some of them with gold bands. I regret not holding on to them, but at the time, they were just too valuable for me to hold on to. I really stretched myself to buy those few pipes. To me, those were the sort of the cream of the crop that she showed me. She may have had lots of others, but of the ones that she showed me, I selected a few. And... I actually struggled to sell them, the ones with the gold bands, and I actually didn't make a huge amount of money on them. But nowadays, those would be probably worth a lot more. But I was very inexperienced at the time. But anyway, so amongst that tobacco, anyway, going into that house, she had two or three rooms with different things in them. One of the rooms was purely dedicated to the tobacchiana, like the jars, pipe racks, lighters, books, and stuff like that. So I bought a bunch of books. She gave me a couple of books without charge, which was very nice. I got a few lighters. I didn't take any pipe racks or anything like that because I had enough of those at the time. She had an amazing thing, which was a little sort of like a framed cabinet that had two doors, and it had all the stages of making a Dunhill pipe. So you had a block of briar, then the next stage of how the basic bowl was carved, then the next stage and the next stage. It was about 8 different pieces, or maybe even more, of all the different stages of completion of a pipe, all the way down to a completed pipe. And at the time, I desperately wanted to buy that. And I offered her, I think, a few hundred pounds. That's all I could afford at the time. And she said she didn't really know the value of it and was going to put it on eBay or get some more advice on it. And she did eventually put it on eBay. I don't think it made a huge amount of money, but it certainly made a few thousand pounds. I was quite surprised at the time. But it was certainly a collector's item. The pipes were not for smoking. They were all tacked onto the board. They were probably drilled on, so it probably had holes in them and stuff like that. So they weren't for smoking. It was purely as an item of history kind of thing of Dunhill pipes. And certainly would be very collectible for a Dunhill collector or a Dunhill aficionado. But that was really interesting. I still have a couple of the very old jars or tins that I bought there. For instance, this one here. I've never opened it. It's been sitting in my drawers. This is Borkum Riff whiskey. And it's a huge thing, but I tried Borkum Riff once when I was on holiday. I had run out of tobacco. I didn't really take much with me. Very early stages of pipe smoking. And so I bought, not a tin, I bought a pouch of Borkum Riff. It was in some seaside town. And I loaded my pipe and I literally smoked half a bowl and I chucked it away because I got mad tongue bite from it. I don't know if maybe now I'd enjoy it. I've got no idea. You know, maybe now using filters, I would absolutely love it. You know, with the whiskey flavor, Blend 131 was one of my favorite whiskey tobaccos, a fantastic tobacco if you're into proper aromatics. So one of the blends that I bought there was Amphora Full Aroma. And I tried that tobacco and I really enjoyed it. It was very flavorful. Let's see if we can find you the contents of it. Amphora Full Aroma. Let's see what Tobacco Review says. You can still buy it anywhere. I mean, it's an over-the-counter blend kind of thing. And it says here, it's made by McLaren. Centuries of tobacco craftsmanship go into Amphora Full. In addition to the Virginia tobaccos, an exact amount of Burley and Oriental tobaccos from three continents balance the blend. And the result is a well-rounded and slow-burning blend. Let me see what the contents are. So it's Burley, Kentucky, Oriental, Turkish, and Virginia. And the flavorings are cocoa, chocolate, floral essences, orange, and raspberry. I don't know if I knew that, if it had those kind of flavorings in it, but it's a very interesting smoke. I enjoyed it thoroughly at the time. I guess I could do with maybe trying it again. But at the time, I fell in love with it. And that's where I first really discovered Amphora Blends. And obviously the natural progression from trying the full was to try the other varieties. So you have the Amphora Full. You have Amphora, now you have Kentucky as well, which was brought in, I don't know how many years ago, maybe 5 or 6 years ago, something like that. It was fairly recent, I think, in addition. And you have the Amphora Virginia. There is another one, but I can't remember what it's called. I think it's maybe got Latakia, I'm not sure. But for me, the Amphora Virginia is the best one. For my personal palate, I like it. It's got beautiful flavors. It's smooth. You get a good retrohale, as I said. And I think I'm going to keep this on my table. Going to get back into it. And I do need to find the other three pouches. I ended up, you know, doing a tobacco sale at the time, selling quite a bit of that tobacco. So that must have been one of the first tobacco sales that I did, actually. And I guess I got a taste for it. Anyway, so that's a little bit of history about my connection with Amphora. And I've got Mordechai Ezrati to thank for it. A side note, I know I've said all this stuff before, but a side note, amongst the stuff that I got there was, I think it was a McBaron, or I can't remember which brand it was, but I still have it somewhere. It was a grape, the flavouring was grape. It was a pouch, but actually it looked like a normal tobacco pouch, but inside it was a recording device, which led me to believe that maybe either people were recording him or he himself was, perhaps had some interesting side activities that he was involved in. I think I read somewhere or heard somewhere that some people thought he was involved with Mossad, an Israeli citizen, or possibly just in his business, you know, maybe it was just a convenient way of recording conversations, you know, business deals and that kind of thing. You know, being a pipe smoker, it's quite natural for him to have a tobacco pouch on the table. So it could have been something as simple as that. I've certainly worked for people who are like that. You know, some people who kind of get high up in the business world, they often have the need to prove deals, prove conversations that have been had. And I certainly worked for one guy in the past who recorded everything. In the days of when technology wasn't that advanced, he had a recording system for recording telephone conversations. And when he had meetings, he would have one of these little recorders, these little tape recorders, somewhere secreted around the desk, and he would record everything. And it's not necessarily paranoia. I mean, it could have been in his case, but it's not necessarily the case. But I think experience leads some people in the business world to have to record things, you know. I can understand that. I just thought it was cool to have something like that, which was like a bit of a James Bond style thing, to have a pipe tobacco pouch which looked and felt like a tobacco pouch and possibly even had tobacco in it, but was actually a recording device. I need to find that. It would be just a cool thing to have a look at again. And clearly nobody realised what it was. And I'm trying to remember if I knew even at the time when I bought it, or if I only discovered it after I'd brought it home. If it was just by chance, or whether at the time when I was looking through the stuff, choosing which ones to buy, I actually saw that there was something up with it. I think it was afterwards, you know. I have to look back, because I definitely spoke about it in videos in the past. But that was cool. I have tried to get in touch with her in the past, but I never got any response. I know that she had to move out of that building. because the family was, I think they were selling it off or whatever, his children, his inheritors were selling the building off. It's like a country house, country mansion, country manor, that kind of thing. So she had to get out of there. It was a shame. I wonder if she still has a lot of that stuff. I know a lot of it after those sales, a lot of it went to America, pretty much lock, stock and barrel. They literally boxed it up and shipped it out. But that was, you know, it's, in a way, you know, when you think about it, you know, you think about all the, I suppose this is with anything in life, not just with pipes, you know, the stuff you accumulate through your life, throughout your life. And then when you shuffle off this mortal coil and then it goes, it's just like, that's it. It's like a wisp of smoke. It's just gone. I suppose, you know, as you get older, you think about your legacy and your mortality and what kind of stamp you've left on the world when you leave it. You know, have you left any stamp on the world? Is there any value to leaving a stamp on this world? You know, so for a lot of people, their family, their children, their progeny is their stamp on the world. That's their legacy. You know, bringing up a family that's a family to be proud of, a family that consists of upstanding, contributing members of society. That, I suppose, is the ultimate legacy to leave behind. But, you know, scholars leave behind, you know, their scholarly works. You know, people who are altruistic, they leave behind, I suppose, their good deeds. And people who are benevolent, who you know, trust funds or people that put up buildings and have their name on the front, I suppose their name is out there for a while until it gets knocked down, maybe a couple of generations later, and somebody puts up a new building. I guess nothing is forever. But like I say, I suppose the greatest legacy is your children. You know, they bring up children and their children bring up children, and then that's, you know, that goes on and on and on. I suppose that's the human experience. You could think about that, you know, all day long. Those are interesting topics. And the older you get, the more you kind of... Anyway, the point I was trying to make was that it's quite sad when you think about how much he put into this Azrati character, how much he put into the hobby, and then it's gone. So in a way, I feel it's a little bit... It's nice, it's cathartic to be able to talk about it and kind of put it out there so that his name is still known, still heard. I guess for me, you know, making pipes and having pipes go all over the world, I suppose that's some kind of legacy. It pales, you know, in comparison to your family, of course, but it's still interesting. It's nice to have some kind of legacy like that. I guess that's interesting. On that note, I'll wish you well. I've been blathering on for nearly 3/4 of an hour, and as usual, had nothing to say when I started off and ended up in this little ramble. Hope it's been of interest. I wish you all a wonderful rest of your week. I'll catch you on the next one.